Yeah, hi Shireen, it's wonderful to be here. Sorry I could not be there with you in person in Delhi, but I have our board week happening this week and earnings and so forth, so it is a busy week here in Bangalore. It's really wonderful to be here. I did not realize that Young Turks is already 16 years old, so it's a sweet 16, so this initiative itself is a bit of a startup that has really picked up some steam. I really want to talk to you and to your audience, Shireen, about AI and startups. And I know that all of you saw some of these amazing innovations, the robotics and the prosthetic arms and things of this nature that you have on exhibit there. And really, when we think about the times that we are living in, it seems that every other day there is something or the other that we hear about some amazing, some breathtaking application of AI. And just the other day I was reading about these kids at OpenAI in San Francisco. They built a robot that can learn to watch, learn an activity by watching a video of that activity or watching someone perform that activity. They, you know, learn to make an omelet, for example, by watching someone make an omelet. And it's really extraordinary examples like this that we hear about every day. And so when we think about what does that mean for us? What kind of, what does that mean for startups? And really, two things come to my mind. First of all, there are amazing applications. There are amazing opportunities for entrepreneurs in these times of artificial intelligence. All the way from AI engines, the core technologies of AI itself, to the applications. When you think about the core technology, when I studied AI as a student in the early 90s, that used to be called the winter of AI, the AI winter. And I worked on some of the deep aspects of core AI technologies as a PhD student. At the time, you know, there was a lot of excitement, but also a lot of skepticism around the use of AI technology. In the last 10 years, partly because of massive advances in computing and availability of large amounts of data, but also because of advances in a particular set of techniques called deep learning and related techniques to that, there have been some really extraordinary applications that have started to emerge. But still, it is early days of AI. There is still a lot more work that needs to be done. Back when I was a student, Marvin Minsky used to talk about the society of mind, about a collection of many techniques that create general intelligence. And we are still quite far from being able to build that. So there is plenty of opportunity in advancing the state of the art in AI itself. But what is even more interesting is to take all these applications, a lot of the software and the systems that are being built, the new platforms that are being built, and to build great applications on top of it. In every walk of life, in every industry, there are AI-driven applications waiting to be built. I read earlier today that a startup from here in Bangalore was acquired by Google, which was doing some of these AI applications. And so when you think about healthcare or banking or insurance or manufacturing, there are really extraordinary applications to be built, as well as in purposeful areas, in farming, in addressing poverty, in addressing fraud and crime, and things of this nature. So one takeaway from all of this for Young Turks, for the entrepreneurs, is that there is a tremendous entrepreneurial sort of opportunities in AI that are in front of us. And literally every field that you can think of is ready to be disrupted, ready to be improved by using AI technology. But there is a deeper reason that I think AI and startups are deeply related. And I think it is important that at Young Turks we think about this. And that is, AI is fundamentally changing the way we think about ourselves. We hear about impact of AI on automation, on jobs. Every other day there is some story or the other that comes out about the role of AI in impacting what happens to the future of jobs in many areas. And I think it is fair to say that perhaps not immediately, perhaps not in the next few years, but certainly in your lifetimes, we are going to see AI technology advance, AI technology evolve to the point where anything, any job, any task, any activity that can be described in a precise way, that can be articulated in a precise way, is going to be done automatically. And so we have to think about what does that mean for us in the times ahead? What does that kind of a advance in technology mean for us, for our humanity? And my own sense is that the great human frontier in the long run, in the time of AI, is problem finding. It is entrepreneurship. It is innovation. See, when we have AI systems that can solve any problem that can be mechanically described, then the human frontier is to find problems. It is to innovate. It is to be entrepreneurial. After all, innovation is no different, no more than looking at the world around us and seeing what is it that we can improve here, what is it that this world is missing. That act of seeing what is not there, that if we were to invent, that would make the world better, that is what innovation is. Of course, today we live in times where innovation is somehow this domain of a chosen few people, and we think that there is innovation, and hey, let's call some innovators and talk about innovation. But really, it is a skill that all of us can learn. After all, when you think about children, we all know four-year-old children who are curious. Pretty much every child is a curious child. They drive us crazy asking the why questions. And somehow, in the school years, this curiosity is driven out of us by the burden of the homework and everything. But that curiosity never leaves us. We all have that innate imagination, the innate creativity within us. And my own sense is that all of you entrepreneurs, all the startups among us, really exemplify that spirit, that creativity, that imagination. And in the times of AI, when all the mechanical, the mechanizable, the routine, the repeatable tasks are going to be automated, it is really that imagination, that problem finding, that is going to create the next opportunity for us. Many hundred million years ago, there was the Cambrian explosion, which created a completely massive number of new species on the planet. And when you read about this, it is quite extraordinary what happened in the Cambrian explosion. There were all these species, and the Earth was largely covered with water, and it is very dark inside the water. But the atmosphere was becoming breathable, and the species started to realize that if they were to develop the sense of sight, to be able to see, that they could actually get a huge advantage. And so the sense of vision, the sense of sight actually emerged, and the biggest explosion of species of life on the planet happened in a very short time frame, about 500 or so million years ago. I think that in the time of AI, a new kind of a Cambrian explosion is in front of us, where we develop a sense of being able to see what is not there, being able to imagine something that will improve things, and then to use AI technology to amplify our ability to get that done. I think the age of entrepreneurship is upon us. That age of AI, in my mind, is the same as the age of entrepreneurship. So I'm really excited that all of you are living this, you are exemplifying this, and all I can say, I mean, here at Infosys, our endeavor is the same. It is to embrace automation and AI and to use that really to propel a culture of massive grassroots innovation and the ability to be entrepreneurial. And all of you are living that, and so I'm really excited that you are doing this, and the age of AI is coming at exactly the right time for all of you as you think about the future and you innovate the future. You know, Alan Kay always says the best way to predict the future is to invent it, and all of you are doing exactly that. So thank you very much, and all the best.
Thank you very much, Vishal Sikka. I know it's a difficult day for you. They're in the midst of board meetings. You've got your results being announced tomorrow. So best of luck from all of us here at Young Turks. But Vishal, also congratulations to you and your team, because, ladies and gentlemen, Vishal Sikka has just been announced the CEO of the Asia region by the Institutional Investor. They've also bagged the CFO Award and the Investor Relation Award. So a big hand to the team at Infosys. Vishal, congratulations to all of you there
thank
at Infosys.
You.
But let me start by asking
thanks
you.
Thanks so much, Irene.
And I can see you dressed up for us. You ditched the black T-shirt and added on a jacket as well for the Young Turks
conference. I have the black T-shirt inside.
Okay. On a serious note, Vishal, you know, we just had you talk about the future of AI. We had Keshav Murugesh of WNS also talk to us about how he believes the future of real tech will be about the coexistence of man and machine. So in that context, then, the big worry is what happens to jobs. You alluded to that. You're talking about automation. Without getting into specifics about Infosys, Vishal, what do you really see as far as the threat when it comes to creation of jobs for human beings, as well as retention of jobs for human beings, given the developments in AI?
That is a question that is on everyone's minds these days. And I was in Dalian at the World Economic Forum event a couple of weeks ago, and this is the topic. There is no doubt that there is going to be a massive impact on jobs. There is absolutely no doubt about it. A lot of the jobs, from the routine ones, bank tellers to grocery clerks, even in our world, administration, file system administration, database administration, and these kinds of jobs, even more sophisticated jobs like MRI imaging, radiology, many of the legal tasks, research tasks are going to be automated. They are already being automated. And so as technology advances, all of these jobs will be impacted. There will be a massive change in jobs. I mean, if you think about the logistics industry, in the United States, there are a huge, several million truck drivers, and it is inevitable that at some point in the near future, we will have autonomous truck driving software and so forth. But the important thing, Shireen, is that all these jobs that we think about that AI will displace, these are all jobs in some sense looking backwards in time. And the nature of technology is that every technology like AI that displaces a job of the past, that same technology creates several jobs of the future. So our brains are sort of wired by nature to think about everything in terms of the past, because that is all we are familiar with. But the reality is that, for every truck driving software that is being built, there is somebody writing that truck driving software, there is somebody maintaining that software, implementing and integrating that software. So there is a lot of job creation that is happening. You know, a friend of mine, Sebastian Thrun, who runs Udacity, he said that the going rate for an autonomous car engineer these days is about $10 million.
Wow.
And so learning to become an autonomous car engineer, every car company, every logistics company, every truck company is going to have autonomous car engineers, people who integrate and implement these systems and so forth. So I think that we have to think about technology as both job displacer, but also a tremendous creator of jobs. And of course, ultimately, at a time when every job that can be precisely articulated becomes automated, we still have that frontier of entrepreneurship, of becoming creative and becoming innovators. I think that this is something that we have to deal very seriously, we have to think very seriously about, but there is absolutely no shortage of jobs in the future, as long as we have that ability to learn, to acquire new skills and so forth.
Okay, so you're in the Ginni Rometty camp, and I remember my conversation with her where she talked about how she believes that we're going to move to new-collar jobs with the advent of AI. But Vishal, you know,
yes,
you,
or no, or you know, Shireen, no-collar jobs.
No-collar jobs. Well, yes, you've given that a completely different spin. But you know, Vishal, are we as a country ready for that kind of transformation? I mean, we keep talking about skilling, reskilling. We're talking about the kind of massive transformation that the Indian IT services sector itself has to make. And we haven't even gone past that just yet. So are we really ready for this kind of shift towards the jobs that AI will create?
Absolutely. I think both those dimensions, the embrace of AI, of learning about AI technology and building AI applications, building AI systems, this is a massive opportunity. And the culture of entrepreneurship, the billion entrepreneurs, the Prime Minister talks about this culture of job makers, not only job takers. A culture of massive entrepreneurship where the creative spirit of a billion people is ignited and is enabled by AI, it is amplified by AI. This is something, if we go down that path, if we learn to do these things, if we learn to acquire these skills, I think the sky is the limit. But there is also at the same time no doubt that if we continue to be focused on delivering the jobs of the past and try to be competitive by being cheaper than the others and so forth, then that journey ends in a bad place. So we have to focus on where the opportunities are. We have to focus on where the future is instead of trying to optimize the past using these very powerful technologies that are with us now.
I know you're in the silent period, so you're constrained from talking specifics, Vishal, but I'm going to ask you a general question. Infosys has been investing in startups. You're looking at startups today as well. You know, broadly, what is it that you look for when you look at a company in the startup space?
I think any company building a future technology, any company, I mean, we invested in a startup here in India that has built advanced drone technologies. We invested in a startup out of Carnegie Mellon that works on air purification using extremely small, extremely lightweight and cheap sensor technology and lots of technologies around complex data analytics. We recently acquired a company called SkyTree, which has built some next-generation machine learning technologies and also bringing together many different kinds of solvers and so forth. So we are constantly looking for technologies and startups to invest in that area, but always aligned with the future, with where the world is going to be, not where things have been in the past.
So let me end then by asking you, I know that Infosys believes in purposeful AI, Vishal, and that's what you've been talking about. Tell me about the one problem, if I were to ask you about a list of problems, the number one problem that you would like to address through your idea of purposeful AI.
There are several, Shireen, in every industry, when I talk to our clients, in every industry, in every domain, there are some extraordinary problems to be solved. But of course, ultimately, the problem of applying AI to learning itself, to improving our humanity, to augmenting and amplifying our ability, whether it is in medicine or simply in our ability to become better by learning better, those are the problems that personally appeal to me a lot. But then beyond that, in every domain, I mean, we have our NIA platform, and in every domain, we have done deployments of AI technology in banking, all the way from fraud and risk detection in a completely dynamic way to understanding complex policies and regulatory compliance and bringing that to life, to product companies where you think about predictive maintenance and complex behavior analysis of customers and deeply understanding costs and forecasting these and things of this nature. So there are really some, we recently did a deployment of a system for a large bank where we were able to automate the capture of regulatory documents, legal documents, and understand wherever there are variations in the agreements and so forth. They had a small team of lawyers that used to do this work, and we were able to completely remove that work and do that with our system. So it simultaneously excites you but also scares you a little bit about the power of these technologies.
So let me end then, Vishal. All set for tomorrow morning. You're going to be back on CNBC TV 18 with your quarterly numbers. Any preview?
On Friday.
On Friday, all right. So wish you the very best of luck. With that, Vishal Sikka, thanks very, very much for joining us here on CNBC TV 18. Thank you for your time here for the Young Turks Conclave. A big hand, ladies and gentlemen, for Vishal Sikka.
Thank you so much. Really a pleasure, Shireen. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. Back to you, Shruti.